Brian and I and Andrew went to high school together, and Josh and William, both of two rival schools.
Bill and I, we both dated the same girl for a while.
As I was joining the band, I was secretly dating this girl who Andrew had dated just because,
we all just started playing, and they kind of like the whole band came together, and it seems like so long ago. And it's so funny now that we've been together for almost 4 years now. It's just surreal to me.
I think there's pretty much only one way to be in a band, or two, I would say. You're either just ultra professional, you do your own thing and you separate and it's done, or your close friends. It's like, I don't really think there are other options. Like, if I wasn't friends with any of these guys, it's like tension alone just from not being close with the people that you have to, you know, be in a 15-passenger van with all day long. It's like, it can get pretty terrible.
Really, we just became a lot closer as friends, as a band. And I think we all learned how to deal with each other. You know, because you're such good friends, and then you come to a point where you start doing so much, spending so much time together. We spend time together socially, spend time together in business, spend time together with music, and then we spend time together in, you know, other states of being, which it's more than family, it's more than friends, it's different.
I consider it pretty much like brothers, like family members. Like, if I get an argument or get a fight with somebody, I love that person, I love the other band, and so I'm over it, you know, I blow off steam, I get over it, and we're done, you know, because you don't have another choice. You know, we're gonna be living with these people for a long time, so might as well get over it quickly and not hold grudges or whatnot.
You know what's funny is that we've all kind of changed together. I think in a lot of ways, we all kind of grew up together in this band, and we all became better musicians, and I think we all became better performers.
I think that the momentum we've gained, things are moving very quickly, I think.
It's kind of like, you know, the saying, a rolling stone gathers no moss. We haven't been gathering moss because we've been rolling along for so long. We haven't stopped, you know, for enough time to gather moss.
But he's right, though.
Yeah.
A rolling stone does not gather moss.
This is f***ing crazy, dude. I remember, like, what, 6 months ago, no one knew something corporate was. And now look at this, dude. Did you get the shot like around the building?
We were just talking about how this is the first time that anything kind of rock star has occurred with this band. This is scary. And
this is really crazy.
This is the first time this ever has ever happened.
You know, this is a good scene.
Yeah, clear area in the stairwell so we can bring him up.
Our brother?
Just like where you were standing.
This is retarded, man.
This is ridiculous!
Hey, the song's coming down the stairs. You guys just got ready for something corporate?
Video. It's going pretty cool. There's my chicks here.
Give me a CD. Huh?
Give me a CD.
No. Give me a CD. I have one for you.
I just said I'm hot.
Only when you're holding the guitar, dude. Yeah. Yeah.
Iggy Pop, baby. Iggy Pop.
What happened, dude?
Nothing. Ice my nuts in between scenes.
Yeah.
Dude, did you bust a nut?
That's true.
Yeah. Dude, what did you do?
You guys ready?
You talked to me a little bit about the recording process of Leaving Through the Window.
It was amazing. I mean, hearing Leaving Through the Window was probably like the highlight of my life altogether. That's pretty much the only thing I ever wanted to do was go in and record, you know, a big record where you could, where you actually had the ability to involve, you know, people in the record that blew your mind, you know, artistically.
Hey, Jim.
Boys, huh?
What?
Yeah, dude, we're making a record.
We worked on the EP with him, and so we had basically gotten to know him. So going back in, it was like, we knew, you know, we knew what it was going to be like. Everybody we worked with on the record was just so talented and so awesome. We got to involve Paul Buckmaster, who did all the early string arrangements with Elton John and David Bowie. And it's like, you know, just had like being in the room with somebody who's like talked to David Bowie or Elton John, it's amazing. You know what I mean? Like let alone worked with them and arranged like some of the most brilliant string charts in rock music. And finally seeing like a 30-piece orchestra play through, you know, 5 of your songs. You know, that was like one of the highlights. Calling out to the astronaut, I need some of what you got. I need to be high. Crawling out of the world she bought. Calling out to one of these things where, you know, we didn't really sleep or eat as much as we should have, and like by the end, it was like we did something cool, you know. So I was really, really proud of it, and I am really proud of it.
We all kind of come together and sit down and just bang them out, and we'll sit there for hours reworking a song, and sometimes we'll come back the next day and be like, wow, it really didn't work. And you know, sometimes we'll just end up saying, okay, well, this song isn't going to work, you know, or this song isn't going to work in this way, we need to totally reevaluate. And we've done that a couple times, but usually that's the way we do it. And we all just stand in a circle, either in a garage or a rehearsal space somewhere, and just sit there for hours working it out, you know.
A lot of times it doesn't seem like it moving quickly because it's a part of our everyday life, but now looking back and actually considering the amount of time we've been doing this and where we are at now, it's really surprising to me that we've been able to build a fan base and go out and have kids know who we are.
We got all these people, man.
In a lot of ways, a live show hasn't changed in the sense that, you know, it's really all about energy, and that's kind of what we like to do. Our goal has always been to just have a really, really energetic and live show where you really feel like kind of you're a part of the audience and vice versa. You know, we kind of like that connection between audience. I've done the shows before where you just kind of get frustrated because you see, I don't know, you see that people are watching and it's just such a detached, separate thing, you know. And what we've always tried to do is really like make our audience know that we're out there kind of with them, and you know, we're gonna sweat and we're gonna get crazy, and you know, if they're gonna jump, we're gonna jump, and you know what I mean? Shake down, you make me break, for goodness sake, I think I'm on the edge of something new with you. Shout out, don't drown the sound, I'll drown you out. You'll never scream so loud as I wanna scream with you. Warp was huge for us, and I'm glad we did it when we did it, because I think, you know, the rest of our touring, we'll see the benefits of that, so I'm glad.
You play on stage, and it's like you take everything inside of you, like all your love, your hate, your everything that makes you want to cry, everything that makes you want to smile, you know, everything that makes you want to laugh, and just feel it. Throw it all out there, and it's just, you know, and it's just all just out in a performance.
It's awesome. I mean, there's so many experiences we have on that tour that it's like, everybody's always like, what's your best story? Or just tell me a story about the Warped Tour, and I can't even conjure up something because there's so much that happened.
Kind of disregarded the gas gauge.
Yeah.
We forgot about that. So we're at mile marker 655 on the 10. 665.
East of San Antonio on the 10 West.
And I'm gonna put some shoes on so I can urinate in the grass without getting bit by snakes.
Creep up on you and the space we put between.
by the second leg of the tour, it was like, you know, it was kind of reflected, you know, like our record had sold a lot more units, and there were a lot more people who I think were aware of the band. We swung up the East Coast, and it was like nearly every show had like you know, a few hundred kids who were, you know, fans of the band and others who knew the songs. You know what I mean? And you kind of went out there feeling a little bit more at home because there were people who really knew what you were about, and even if they were seeing you for the first time, they'd heard your record and would sing along and, you know, would get into it. To be honest, I think the most exciting thing about the past year has been watching the crowd diversify completely, you know, and seeing every you know, possible age and shade and gender and everything. It's like, it's really cool to see how there's a lot of different kinds of people coming out to see our shows now.
To be on the road with four guys that are just the greatest guys, each and every one of them, I care for, you know, just as much as my own family, and they care for me just as much as their own family. And I think that we all know that, and that's probably what keeps us sane and together, and makes it all worthwhile at the end of the day. Because it's like, no matter how much, you know, somebody can do something, you know, to, you know, make you want to scream, you know, you can step back and say, you know, something, you know, my mom and my dad make me want to scream sometimes, you know, but they're still my mom and my dad, and it's the same type of thing. Everyone's had a time when, you know, their girlfriend or boyfriend, you know, is making them crazy and just, you know, driving them up the wall, and everyone's had a time where, you know, you really want the girl and you don't get her, you know? And it's you know, it's all stuff that, you know, especially when you're a teenager, you know, it kind of dominates your life. It's like almost the most important thing that ever happens to you. And, you know, why not write about that?
I can't imagine all the people that you know and the places that you go. When the lights are turned down low, and I don't understand all the things you've seen, but I'm slipping in between you and your big dreams. It's always you and my big dreams, and you tell get out, you can't stand to see me shaking. No, but you let me go. I didn't think so. And you don't wanna be here in the future, so you say the present's just a pleasant interruption to the past. And you don't wanna look much closer, 'cause you're afraid to find out all this hope you had sent into the sky by now had crashed. And it did, because of me. And you bring me back. my guitar, maybe cross the country, become a rock star.
A good 95% of the stuff that you'll hear come out of me is all pretty much just life experience stuff, you know, things that, you know, you collect kind of as you go along. You know, obviously that changes a little bit as environments and scenarios kind of change with you, but I think for me it was always really difficult to write any other way, but then from like just a really honest perspective.
This is because I can spell confusion with a K and I can like it. It's to dying in another's arms, why I had to try it. It's to Jimmy Eat World and those nights in my car, when the first star you see may not be a star.
Just like with the writing and stuff, for, you know, with the new record in mind, I'm just, you know, kind of writing the same way I always have, which has just been to write what you feel and what's happening. And I think that's probably what got us here. So I think the idea is just keep doing just that.